Hey, this is Brian, and today we're going to talk about static equilibrium. That is a topic from chapter 8 in the textbook, and the name is a little bit deceiving because really what we're looking at is the forces and also the torques, so the forces and the torques on things that are not moving. And if things are not moving, the sum of the forces on an object is equal to zero, and the sum of the torques on an object is equal to zero, as you've read about in chapter 8, and that allows us to analyze a whole bunch of different situations, as we'll see today. So here's the thing, and you can read about this in chapter 8 if you'd like. Newton's second law for rotation, it says the angular acceleration is equal to the net torque divided by the moment of inertia. Newton's second law is the acceleration is equal to the net force divided by the mass. And so if I have an object that is not moving and it's not rotating, so not moving, not rotating, we can say that the sum of the forces on it is equal to zero and the sum of the torques on it is equal to zero. That's what we're going to be looking at. That is the case of static equilibrium. And here's the type of thing we're going to analyze. And I'm going to ask this question. What is the point of having a wheelbarrow? Well, one thing that a wheelbarrow does for you is it's got a wheel on the front, and that's kind of implicit in the name. But the other thing is that it lets you pick up larger loads than you otherwise would be able to. And that's the point of the long handles on the wheelbarrow. Let's take a look at a problem. So here's a situation. A man is carrying a 51 kilogram load in a wheelbarrow, and the question is, what upward force must his hands provide? Okay, that's the question we're going to consider. And we're going to start by strategizing. And my strategy is I'm going to treat this as a situation of static equilibrium. And what that does for us is it lets us use all of the technology for static equilibrium. The sum of the forces is equal to zero, and also the sum of the torques is equal to zero. Saying we're treating this as a static equilibrium problem says all this stuff kind of comes along for the ride, and it gives us some really great tools to analyze this particular physical situation. Next step. We're going to prepare, and we have laid out the steps that you want to do for preparation. First off, sketching a simplified view of the situation. Two, locating the object of interest. Three, locate the pivot point. Four, note all the forces where they act, all the forces that act where they act and at what angles. And five, write expressions for the torques for each force. Okay, that is what we need to do. Now, before we do that, I'm going to point out a couple of other things. First off, this is the center of gravity of the wheelbarrow right here. And so the weight force is as if it's acting at the center of gravity. And that's the only weight force we're going to consider because we're ignoring the weight of the wheelbarrow. The other thing I'll note is that there's a pivot point. There's a wheel right here. And the wheelbarrow as a whole is going to pivot around that point. Okay? And so that is another crucial piece of the puzzle. And now we're ready to actually do that sequence of steps. So we'll dim the slide so that I can sketch over top of it. And the first piece of the puzzle we're asked to do is to sketch a simplified view of the situation. And there's two parts to that we want to get as part of it. One is locating the object of interest, and then we're going to locate the pivot point. Now, it might seem, looking at this, that the object of interest is the person. As a matter of fact, the question asks about the forces hands must provide. But that's not what we're looking for. The object of interest is something with spatial extent that has forces applied at different places. And the object of interest in this case is the wheelbarrow. Because the wheelbarrow has forces applied at a couple of different places. It's got some spatial extent, and it's in static equilibrium. It's not accelerating, and it's not rotating. And so as a consequence, the sum of the forces on it is equal to zero. The sum of the torques is equal to zero. And let's go ahead and sketch a simplified view of the situation. And I'm just going to draw a straight line right here that goes from the person's hands through the center of gravity out here to the wheel. That's my view of the wheelbarrow. I've just simplified it. And I'm interested in basically its horizontal spatial extent. Let's look at the forces that act on it. Well, there's an upward force from the person's hands, and I'm just going to call that F sub hand. In fact, it's going to be a normal force, but there could be some friction force going on. But anyway, there's a force that has to be provided by his hand. Now, there's a weight force of the load in the wheelbarrow. And kind of implicit in this, it's a 51 kilogram load. That's like 110 pounds. Let's assume we can neglect the actual weight of the wheelbarrow itself. The whole load has a center of gravity that's right here, okay? And so there's gonna be a force that's directed there, and the force that's there is the weight of the load. The third thing we have to do is we have to locate the pivot point. And the pivot point is going to be the wheel, basically. And I'm looking at the axle of the wheel or where the wheel touches the ground, but there's something pivoty here. Something where, and you can see if he lifts his hands up, it will pivot around that point. So that's going to be our view of the situation. Okay, now notice this as well. What I'm going to do be doing torques, I've got some vertical extent going on here. But I've just ignored the vertical extent and I've taken that whole wheelbarrow and I shrunk it down to like a single line that we have right here. And since I shrunk it down to a single horizontal line, the distances that I'm given are basically the perpendicular distance from where the forces are acting to the pivot point. And so when I'm solving for torques, I'm going to use this expression. I'm going to say the torque is equal to R perpendicular times F. That's what I'm going to be looking for. Oh, I forgot one force, by the way. There's also an upward force at the pivot. There's also a force here, and that's a normal force or a friction force or something. I'm just going to call it F sub pivot. I'm not exactly sure. Okay, next thing. Oh, goodness. Note all the forces that act, where they act and what angles. We did that. All the forces that I've drawn are acting at a right angle, which is good. So we don't have to worry about F perpendicular. In fact, we're worrying about R perpendicular as we saw. Okay. Next piece is we're going to write expressions for the torques for each force. Okay, so for the hand, torque is equal to R perpendicular times F. That's how we compute torque. So for the hand force, the distance is 1.1 meters, and the force is the force of the hand. So the torque is 1.1 meters times F hand. Okay, for the weight force, the force is just equal to W, and the perpendicular distance from the line of action of the force to the pivot point is going to be 0.25 meters. Okay, and so the torque due to the weight force, and I'm going to label it as torque sub W, torque due to the weight is equal to 0.25 meters times W. Oh, by the way, I better label the torque here. This is going to be the torque due to the hand force, T sub H or tau sub H. Now we have a force at the pivot. So in principle, there would be a torque at the pivot. But there isn't because the force or the torque is equal to R perpendicular times F, but the distance from the pivot to the pivot is zero. So since that is zero, this term of the equation crops goes away. It is just equal to zero, so there is no torque at the pivot. And that really simplifies the situation significantly because looking ahead to the solve step, we can say this. I've got the hand torque is making the wheelbarrow rotate clockwise. The weight torque is tending to make the wheelbarrow rotate counterclockwise. So looking ahead, that tells me that I can just take those two torques and set them equal to each other. Let's go on to our next step. Next step is solving, and we've listed two steps. One is balancing the torques, and two is balancing the forces. And it turns out we might not even have to do step two. Let's do step one first and see if step two is a necessity. Now let's remember the torques that we had. We had a torque due to the hands, the force due to the hands, and that was tending to make the wheelbarrow rotate upward. And we said the torque due to the hand force was equal to 1.1 meters times the force of the hand. We also had a torque due to the weight force. That was equal to 0.25 meters times the weight. And remember, that torque was tending to rotate the wheelbarrow counterclockwise. Oh, heavens to Betsy, those are the only two torques. And if the wheelbarrow is not rotating, we can just say that the torque due to the hand force is equal to the torque due to the weight. And so I can equate those two. And if I do that, I get 1.1 meters times F sub hand is equal to 0.25 meters times the weight force. But the weight force is just m times g. Oh, and I know what m is. It's 51 kilograms. G is equal to 9.8 meters per second squared. And just to clarify, m times g in this case is going to give me a weight force of 500 newtons. We'll use that to help us with our assessment. And now we have everything in the expression except for the force of the hand, and we can solve for the force of the hand. And if we do it, we get 115 newtons is the force of the hand. And so we don't even have to balance the forces. We could, but we're done. Because the question asks, what upward force must his hands provide? And we've said the force of the hands is just equal to 115 newtons. Next piece, of course, is to assess it and see if this makes sense. So here's the thing. The wheelbarrow has a load in it that has a weight of 500 newtons, but to hold it up, the person only has to provide a force of 115 newtons. Well, that's only about a quarter as much force. And the reason that makes sense is because if you look at the distance that the hands are from the pivot point, that's 1.1 meters, more than four times the distance of the weight, or the center of gravity, the point where the weight force acts from the pivot, which is only 0.25 meters. And so if I have four times the distance, I'm going to have one quarter of the force. Okay, and that makes sense. So my assessment is, yes, this absolutely makes sense. And it matches with my experience of the way the world works. When I have to carry a heavy load in my garden, you better believe I use a wheelbarrow. And I picked one up at a garage sale, and it's awesome, and it's got very, very long handles, and I can pick up and roll around really, really heavy loads. And so the net result is, yes, indeed, this does make sense. Now, I want to look at an example of forces in your musculoskeletal system. And this is the place where it gets really interesting, and there's wonderful biological applications, and we'll do a bunch of this in class. But I look at this situation. Suppose a person is lifting a 100 newton weight, and we say here we're going to ignore the weight of the arm. And to a pretty good approximation, you can do that in that case. 100 newtons, that's about a 10 kilogram mass, or it's about, that's about 20 pounds or so. So that's a big weight. It's more than the weight of your arm. So we're going to ignore the weight of your arm for this problem. And the question asks two things. First off, it asks, what is the force provided by the muscle? And then two, what is the force in the joint? Okay, that's our situation. Those are the questions that were asked. First step, of course, strategize. And we're going to say, we're going to treat this as static equilibrium. That's our strategy, is to say we're going to treat this as a static equilibrium problem. And since we've said it's a static equilibrium problem, it brings us the fact that the sum of the torques is equal to zero, the sum of the forces is equal to zero, and we can use all those techniques to help us wrap our mind around this particular problem. Next piece of the puzzle is to prepare. And I've dimmed this out so that we can sketch on top of it. So, next. And then the steps that we have in terms of our preparation, we're going to sketch a simplified view of the situation, locate the object of interest, locate the pivot point, know all the forces that act, where they act, and what angles, and write expressions for the torques due to each of the forces. Okay, so here's how we're going to do this. First off, we're going to sketch a simplified view of the situation by locating the object of interest and the pivot point. Well, the object of interest, the thing that has forces applied at multiple places, is the arm. Okay, that's basically the pivoting object. That is going to be the object of interest. Forces will be applied at different places, and we're going to balance the forces and the torques that act on the arm. Next piece of the puzzle is we locate the pivot point. Well, the pivot point's pretty obvious. It's just at the elbow joint. I mean, this is actually a point where it pivots. So, object of interest is the arm. Okay, pivot point is the elbow. And then we have to note all of the forces that act, where they act, and at what angles. Well, this weight exerts a downward force on the hand, and the downward force is just going to be equal to the weight force, okay? Because the hand has got to be pushing upward on the weight with a force of 100 newtons to counteract gravity, and so as a consequence, the weight is pushing downward on the hand with a force of 100 newtons. Okay, and I'm just going to call that... I'm going to call that the force due to the weight. Okay, that's the force due to the weight. Now there's an upward force right here that's due to the lifting muscle, okay? And I'm just going to call that F sub M. That's the force of the muscle. In fact, we could also call it the force of the tendon because the muscle is connected to the arm by a tendon, but then we'll just go with that. That is one of the things that we're looking for. And there's also going to be a force in the joint. Now, we don't know the direction of the force in the joint, but I'm just going to assume that it's downward. And if it's not, we'll figure it out. And I'll show you how we figure it out. That's another thing we're going to be looking for. And just looking at this is like, man, I certainly don't have enough to solve this using Newton's second law. I know the arm isn't going anywhere. But I have two forces that I don't know and only one that I do. I don't have enough to be able to solve by saying the net forces are equal to zero. But the good news is we can say something about the torques. But if we're going to do that, we're going to write down expressions for each one of the torques to simplify that. Now the torque due to the weight is equal to, and we're going to use this, we're going to use R times F perpendicular, okay? Because I'm given the distances from where the forces are applied to the pivot point, and I only want the perpendicular components of the forces, but it turns out all the forces are perpendicular. So everything works out. The torque is just equal to R times F perpendicular, but F perpendicular is just equal to F, so it's going to be equal to 0.35 meters times 100 newtons. That's the torque due to the weight force. Now I've also got a torque due to the muscle, and the torque due to the muscle is going to be equal to the distance, which is 4.040 meters times the force of the muscle. And how about the torque at the joint? Well, the torque at the joint is the pivot point, so any force that is applied there can't produce any torque. So there is zero torque at this point. And then, as happened before, we've got two forces that produce torques. The muscle torque is rotating the arm counterclockwise. The weight torque is rotating the arm clockwise. And so as a consequence, we can say that those two torques must be equal to each other. And that's where we'll start when we do our solve step. Okay, so we're going to solve, and the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to balance the torques. Now we said there were two forces that were acting. There was an upward force due to the muscle we called F sub M, okay? And the torque due to that, the torque due to the muscle force was just equal to 0.040 meters times the force of the muscle. We also had a downward force due to the weight, and that was a force of 100 newtons, and the torque due to the weight was just equal to the distance, 0.35 meters times 100 newtons. So what we can do is we can equate those two, because the torque due to the muscle is rotating the arm counterclockwise. The torque due to the weight is rotating it clockwise. One is raising the arm, one is lowering the arm, and since those are the only two torques that we have, they have to be equal to each other. Because remember, we said there is also a force at the joint, but the torque due to that force is equal to zero. There's no torque due to the force acting at the joint. So we can say the torque of the muscle is equal to the torque of the weight. And if we do that, I can just equate this expression and that expression, and I can solve for the force of the muscle. Okay, and if I do that, I get a force of the muscle is equal to 875 newtons. Now I want you to notice something. That is almost 9 times the actual weight force. So when you lift something and you're doing a biceps curl, okay, you are supplying 9 times as much force as the actual weight of the object you're lifting. And we've left out the weight of your arm, so it's actually more than that. So when you go to the gym and you do a curl, be impressed, because your muscles are actually applying way more force than you knew. Now let's go ahead and do the next step, which is balancing the forces. Now there's 875 newtons pulling upward because of the force in the muscle. There's 100 newtons pulling down due to the force of the weight. And so as a consequence, the force of the joint must push downward as we've drawn it, and the magnitude is just going to be 775 newtons, because the net force on the arm has to be equal to zero as well. So we did, the sum of the torques was equal to zero. We can also do the sum of the forces is equal to zero. And summing the forces and set them equal to zero lets us say that the force in the joint is 775 newtons, and in fact, it should be pushing down. So here's our final situation. We end up having 100 newton downward force due to the weight, 875 newton upward force due to the muscle, and 775 newton force in the joint. So when you perform relatively modest everyday tasks, the forces that your muscles are applying are gigantic. And that's one of the takeaway lessons from today. Assess, does this all make sense? It does, because the 100 Newton force is applied out here at a huge distance from the elbow. The muscle force is applied very close to the pivot point, okay? And so as a consequence, we expect a significantly larger force. So does this make sense? The answer is it does. That is our last step of the problem. We're gonna do more problems like this in class. We do more problems like this in recitation, more problems like this in the laboratory. And now we're gonna move on and talk about our next topic, which is springs. And that's something which is treated in chapter 8. We're not gonna talk about it in any detail, but I want you to be aware of it because it is something we will need to know about when we get to chapter 14 and we start talking about oscillations.